Hi, Steve Stahlberg here with a monthly painting video number 53, made in Kuala Lumpur, May 2018. This is a creature concept, or just a story concept maybe, because I'm not showing the whole creature, so maybe you wouldn't call it a character concept, but for some particular story moment, you know, in a movie. Basically a gigantic demon using the earth as his anvil. Not inspired by this book, which I read about 40 years ago, not consciously anyway. Again, it started with a sketch I made quite some time ago, a few years I think, that never seemed good enough first, but I saved everything, so I kept it around, and over time I kept working at it, leaving it, coming back to it. That's the first version. I gave him two hammers, because two is better than one. Or an asteroid that hits the Earth, which is what that book is about. Quite a good book, second version there. Smaller hammer, some changes there, some more details added. And a third version, with a slightly bigger hammer again. Things keep changing. More detail added there. And so yeah, then I finally started on for real, and started recording. And it was yet again time for the dreaded reference shoot, because it's always better with reference. Ew, sorry about that. This helped me see, though, that the angle was all wrong in the sketch, among other things, as you see. If you look at the sketch again here, and also note that I'm editing the photo here, I'm painting on top of it, making the hammer bigger, the head smaller, and so... And here's the sixth version. After redrawing it one more time, because I was totally not happy with the first version, after much rescaling and warping, I added a passenger jet, as you can see, a six-engine plane, because I was trying to make it as big as possible. There does actually exist one like that, similar to that. Now starts the blocking in and painting, using grayscale first. The serratus is turning out a bit too large and low there for the average anatomy, but oh well, he's a demon, so. Note that I'm putting the highlights of the demon on a separate layer here. You can see here, above the gray base. You'll see why in a minute. I'll lock that layer and I'll be able to edit it separately from the other layer. It's something I don't usually do, but in this case it sped up the process a bit. Also note that I'm using a technique I've talked about before to let the main light source be part of the image. That's the hammer strike right there. Actually, it's part of the reason for the image, the hammer strike. So in this case, yeah, the explosion. That resulting exposure. Now I'm going to apply gradients across there. That's the reason why it makes it much easier to control the gradient of the light and color that comes out of that explosion, like this. And then I'm going to add a second one here for the base layer, from kind of purplish here to different blue over here, and another gradient for the hammer. And now I'm colorizing the gradient map. I'm using the gradient map tool on the hammer, remapping the gray gradient to a color which is warm at the bottom and cooler at the top, and the same for the background, putting a gradient on the background, a circular gradient on the background, and I'm playing with the colors. It makes it much easier to play with the colors. You have the background here separate, base layer for the demon, highlight layer for the demon, hammer layer, those four layers basically. The plane is on its own layer too, but it's not terribly important. I changed the colors of the plane a lot back and forth during the process, but yeah, it just makes it really a lot easier to keep them all on separate layers. Of course, I've talked before about how I don't really like layer masks and things that I like to just paint something and then lock the layer, and if I don't like where the edge, you know, the shape of the edge, other people would just edit the layer mask, and I'm sure that's more convenient if you're used to that, but for me, I don't like how it kind of doubles the stack of stuff here to look at, doubles or triples depending on what you do with it. I have a circular cloud here which is actually not there later. I put it on its own layer, and I actually switched off the layer at the end. I wasn't happy with it, but yes, that's another use for layers. You switch it on and off, and if you can't tell right away, you go away, come back later, and keep playing with the switch button, on off, and sooner or later you should be able to tell which one you like the best. So, yeah, I liked it off, so I left it off. More detailing here. I'm starting detailing on the hammer here. Later you'll see I will change this gradient quite a lot on the hammer. I'll make it much darker up top and more reddish, orangey reddish at the bottom, more like lava. And actually right at the end I actually add kind of cracks of lava or something red hot. Just because it looked cooler. The physics behind the whole thing is at a certain point I just, you know, say screw it. I try to stick to physics as much as possible, but what the image looks like is more important. It's always more important than if it's believable or not. Selecting areas and a bit of airbrushing. Well, I'm not sure if that was it. That was probably a sharp edge brush. I used both. And I'm erasing some parts of the sketch here, which is on a top layer. Because I always go overboard with I indicate the shadows with its cross-hatching, and then I find that I don't really need the cross-hatching as I start coloring in. But anyway, in this case I didn't need the... I think I used a little bit of the sketch right at the end, like a faint layer of some parts of the sketch. If you want to keep the sketch, of course make a copy of it and keep the copy invisible. That's what I did. But yeah, I erase everything that I don't need, and then here you see it fading a little bit. And I still kept those, because these a few of these lines that are still surviving from the sketch are cool to mix into the final mix. Painting the handle there, more detailing. probably jump ahead a little bit. Yeah, I started the process of darkening the hammer. It's kind of frustrating to watch, maybe, because I actually ended up darkening it a lot more than this, but I'm kind of careful by nature, so I kind of go slow, step by step, bit by bit. And these highlights are also on a separate layer, because that made it easy to edit them later. I made them less saturated blue, they're quite blue right now. Detailing the clouds here. Yeah, that six engine jet looks like this. Let's see if I can double click one. Yeah, this one. That's what it looks like. I didn't copy it completely. Also tried to capture the colors from this reference. This is a painting, of course, but I use it as a reference for the colors. Meteor strike, I suppose. It's supposed to be. Actually, could be a good illustration for the book cover that I mentioned earlier. Still detailing the hammer here. And here, something fun. I make a mask, smudging parts of the mask to create sharp areas and blurry areas. And what I'm trying to do is capture the circular rings that you get in wood. Or we could see this as brass with a circular polish added on top. So here I'm just trying to get the right two brush strokes. After putting some care into the mask with just two brush strokes, or three there, yeah, if you if you want to be strict. But it's sometimes makes it so much easier to have a good mask. Just temporary, just to get rid of the mask after. You know. First select it and then smudge it. And if you're wondering how to get that mask look red like that and be editable, it's just here, it's the quick mask button. You toggle it on and off there. And my smudge brush, as I've mentioned many times before, is one of my most useful tools that I use. Even for these kind of details here, I'll smudge the heck out of every pixel almost in the whole painting eventually. It's just a really convenient and easy way to get directional blur. Varied directional blur. To squiggle the brush back and forth in one single direction will give you directional blur in that direction. It's quite nice. Still detailing. Added these contrails or these kind of clouds, kind of like the trail that a meteor leaves as it passes through the atmosphere. I'm improving the hand, the fingers here, making it more like the reference. And this is where I got the reference out again and zoomed in and used it at a sort of a closer scale. There's only two fingers here right now, but there's another two I'm going to add in a moment. See, you can squiggle like this, you can make ugly squiggles, and then you can come back with a smudge tool and just sort of make it beautiful. Kind of oil painty. And here are some red lines, construction lines, helping with the construction on a separate layer. Because as you can see, the initial sketch was very wobbly. So I want to tighten that up a little bit. And then select the whole belt by itself and put that on its own layer. Makes it easier to work with also. Bringing those construction lines back. And now I'm using those lines, the red lines, to kind of follow them and apply that onto the belt layer. Just a way to tighten up the initial sketch. I don't know why I make them red. I think they show up, red shows up more, and these kind of layers, I never use them, I never drop them down onto the illustration. The initial sketch I usually, sometimes I, or usually sometimes, often I do use parts, as I said, of the initial sketch. Not sure why, I think it's because I'm not thinking about using it later, I'm just sketching. I get into the zone, I just sketch along. It kind of turns out, often it turns out to have its own kind of natural and immediate charm. So I can pick a few parts of that initial sketch and use that and drop it down to the painting. But these construction lines are different. I'm using rulers and I'm using ellipses, and they are not, they're not nice lines to have in your final painting. So and now we have more details. Background clouds have been added. Quite simply, selection and then airbrush. Darkening the sky. I went so many times, back and forth, about how dark to make this part, how dark to make this part, how dark to make this part. I was going for, I don't know if I succeeded, but I was really going for the plane to be the darkest or highest contrast, hammer to be next, his hand to be next, and his arm and torso to be next, and this distant hammer over here to be the faintest and the lowest contrast, just in order to get this deep atmospheric perspective effect, and to really get the size of the thing, like from the hammer, from one hammer to the other hammer, maybe it's like hundreds of kilometers or something like that, even 1,000. I don't know, I haven't thought about any exact numbers, but you get what I mean. Just trying to make him look as big as possible. Like looking at a mountain range, this would be the closest part of the mountain range, and the other hammer would be the far part of the mountain range. Like almost, probably pretty much past the horizon, like way back. And now I'm detailing his face, and again I'm going back to the reference photo that I shot, which I'm not going to show here. And yeah, using that, of course my teeth aren't jagged like this, but that is beside the point. The shape of the teeth don't really matter. What I'm after here is the highlights. The highlights and the shadows. I follow the shape established by the drawing, but from the photo I tried to take the shading, the highlight, the darkness, the shadows and the color. Except it would have been, as I said, much easier if I had remembered to light the thing properly when I was taking those photos. slipped my mind. I thought about going back and redoing them, but it was embarrassing enough doing it once, so. Jump ahead a little bit. This is very tedious. Even at 10 times the speed, it's tedious to watch. Moving one tooth. Just copy paste and move the copy. And you can see here traces of the original sketch that are in there. For some people it's easy to be random like this, but it's not easy for me. So whenever I find something random like this, which I find looks nice and you know, chaotic and nice and organic, I try to keep it, I try my best to keep it in onto the end, into the final. Otherwise I do have a tendency to polish too much, to straighten things too much, to have too much symmetry, to have too much predictable things going on in my paintings. Yeah, not happy with the level of detail here. It's quite smooth. Being so huge, he needs more detail, so I'm trying to rough up his skin, trying to add detail. And it's not hard to do, you just have to remember to color pick from where you are. You can't really go in here and add any darker darks than are already there, or and you can't add any brighter brights than are already there. You just gotta color pick from what is already there. So that's a color pick from the Terminator, from, you know, from the shadow region, and then pull that into the light region, and then color pick from the highlight, and then push the highlight bits into the shadow region. And it's very tedious, but it can be rewarding in the end. Let's see how this works out. I'm trying to make him kind of wrinkly, maybe even like almost scaly, or like an old tree or something. Just messed up skin. Gnarly. He's almost done now. But you get the idea. It's important, it's very important to color pick, because it's much slower, and you almost always get the color wrong if you try to set the color here, if you try to actually define it explicitly. More detail on the belt. I'm also not happy with the belt detail, there's not enough. So I'm on the construction layer and adding lines there, and then I go back to the belt layer and add what I'm using that as a guide. Kind of engraving detail into the metal. It's supposed to be metal. I don't know if it looks like metal. Could be rock also. What do I know? Or some unholy material from another dimension, a hell dimension. Yeah, so I'm on the belt layer itself and color picking belt color from shadow part of the belt, and then I was just sort of adding in the detail from there. Here's that lava detail I told you about earlier. Adding it into the grooves that I've already established, these dark areas that I've already established, that are grooves, and now I'm just sort of playing with how red it is, how dark red it is, how bright it is, how opaque it is, adding a little bit of blur, but reducing it a lot in the end, using the airbrush on a locked layer to color it from yellow to red. Yellow at the bottom, red at the top. Well, it's done. Some refinements, some additions. I hope you like it. Let me know if you have any feedback or questions. Thanks for your support, and see you next month.